G'day, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome here, of course, to beautiful Kelowna, the ESL TV studios. My name is Mitch Leslie, and I will be your host for this weekend. And it is my distinct pleasure to welcome you all to the Wargaming.net League EU Season 4 Finals. And what a season we have seen. Titans, Virtus Pro, Standing Tall, not dropping a single series. And of course, Polish Juggernauts, EPS, not too far behind either. But before we delve into the nuts and bolts of this weekend, let's have a look at our schedule over these 2 days. And you can see today, obviously, we are starting off with our first few games. It will be School Bus and TCM going up against each other first. Kazda Crew and C-Play to follow. We will have our losers bracket match, our winners bracket match, and of course, our decider to see which teams are going through to tomorrow. Of course, that features our semi-finals, our third and fourth place match, and our grand final. So now we know the bit of the lay of the land for at least these next couple of days. Let's have a look at the brackets for today. As I said, it's a double elimination bracket, best of 5 games. And you can see here, we have our 4 teams playing through for their place tomorrow. School Bus and TCM, obviously our first 2 teams going head-to-head. We will then see Kazda Crew and C-Play go as well. Now, teams dropping down to the loser's bracket still have an opportunity to make it towards tomorrow. But of course, they need to fight their way out. All right, well, that's probably enough for me. Let's go check in with our experts for this weekend. Now, it's a rare thing for a POM to have both a warm smile and a strong handshake, but Luke Dorjanella definitely has both of those. So let's pass it over to Luke and his team of experts at the desk. Luke, take it away.
Thank you, Mitch. Thank you. It's very nice to be warmly welcomed by an Australian. But here we are at the analyst desk, live in Cologne. I'm really happy to be here, and I'm joined with 3 experts from the Gold Series. On my left here, Mr. Wilkie from the Freefall team for Season 4, now the Drooling Leprechauns. Welcome here. To his left, Carmen from Lemming Train from the Grand Finals. You guys would have recognized him there. Denial Esports for the whole of Season 4.
Hello.
And on my right, we have Snitzel from Woosa, the Silver medalist from the WCG. How are you doing, sir? How are you feeling being here in Cologne?
I'm really happy to be in the ESL studios in Cologne, and I'm really looking forward to the games today.
Yeah, you actually didn't travel far. You're actually quite local, aren't you, to Cologne?
Yes, I'm like 50 kilometers from here, so it's a 1-hour drive. And I'm here.
Well, it's great having you, and I can't wait to see your opinion on these upcoming matches. And Mr. Wilkie, getting more famous here in Finland, doing your articles and your social media there. How does it feel to be in the center of the World of Tanks scene in Cologne?
It's awesome. It's really good to be here. Of course, I would be like to be playing maybe next time, so let's do the analyst this time.
Well, it gives you the edge being able to see all these guys' tactics live here. Spying, that's it. And Mr. Carmen, from the Grand Finals, you are now invited to the technical desk. How are you, sir?
I'm very good. I'm really happy to be here. And like Wilkie said, I would like rather be playing, but first time I will be here as an analyst desk, I will try as hard as possible, you know, to give you opportunity to get into the tactics. I hope it'll be interesting for you guys. And I'm really waiting, you know, for the first match, TCM versus School Bus. Some classic.
Okay, well, for your social media fix, we do have Melee the Beautiful, as always.
Thank you very much, and a warm welcome from my side as well. I'm Melee, and I'm standing here in our lovely social media corner, where all the social media magic will happen. And of course, besides useful information and backstage pictures and behind the scene information maybe, we also have challenges, of course, and where you can win bonus codes and some Razer gear, as I heard. But later, more to that. Of course, you will have the chance to vote for your favorite team before every matchup and well, win bonus codes, of course. So people who watch the season, the league, know the drill. For those who don't, just head over to facebook.com/WGLEU. The vote is already up and running, and you can vote for your favorite team in the next matchup, which will be School Bus versus TCM, of course. And by doing so, and by predicting the exact scoreline of this matchup, you have the chance to win 5 bonus codes. And I think that's pretty much a good reason to do. And for the audience here, of course, you can do it via your mobile phones as well. And people, let's see how this vote will end. And of course, we do have other challenges prepared for you guys, besides a daily challenge and, well, some type 59 to win, I've heard. And but later more to that, of course. That's all from my side. Follow us on Twitter as well, of course, to stay updated during the stream. Even if you can't watch the stream at some point today, we're not mad, but we want you to follow our Twitter account to stay updated, of course, so you won't miss any action going on the servers. And yes, that's all from my side now, and back to Luke.
Thank you very much. Now you know how to get involved, get involved. And that's enough about social media. Let's talk about the actual matches we have got going. First one, School Bus versus TCM. So School Bus, a team that are very veteran. You might know them better as Synergy, but they shred their captain after the grand finals. And now Arklet is in charge. These guys, super veteran team. We know all about them. But let's find out what the experts have actually said. So what do you think about School Bus?
I think School Bus is a really seasoned team. And even the air inside of the team has been cleaned out now that the Arklet is on the lead because he's so calm person. So I think they will do good. And I'm really waiting what they have to offer us in these games.
Yeah, well, they have got a lot of experience offline. They are a really powerful team. And let's meet them. Let's meet School Bus.
I think that team success is not just about training, it's also about team spirit, it's about how people communicate between each other in the team. It's all factors put together.
We don't have a captain, and that's why every player can think about tactics and every player can improve our game during the battle. It's not a game of a captain or one best player. It's a team game.
Our biggest strength is that we play together for a long time. We know each other, we can communicate real fast. We don't even have to tell each other how to do different stuff during the battle, because we just know how we do it and what to expect from your teammate.
I'm Apple Wow, and thanks for your support, and pow, 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 man!
Pow, 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 Apple Wow, MVP, powered by Razer. What can we say about him?
Yeah, he was chosen by Oli, so Laughter, the one of the commentators, and Pansy. I have agree with them. It's one of the best players in their team. He is from the beginning of the School Bus, Dignitas or Synergy, however you want to call the team. He was always on this pow, 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 so clipping tanks. He's always behind, but he knows when he needs to do a move, to take a shot from his friend, to he's have a really great accuracy, and I just waiting what he will be doing today with the match against TCM. I think he will be the big thing is on his backs. He must carry the team because it's the first game, and loser of it is almost down. You cannot make any more mistakes. So I think very big responsibility for him, but he can handle it.
Well, it is a big responsibility, and he's had a lot of this showmanship on him before the grand finals. They were in a little bit of trouble in the group stage, and it started falling apart. So, as you said, the first match is really important for them. They need to get their momentum going. But they do have a new captain. We do have to brush on that these guys might be performing slightly differently than they normally do because of this change in captaincy. As we know with your experience on the offline events, the captaincy and the cohesion of the team is really important.
Yeah, it is. Like, the pressure on offline events is really high, and the captain needs to get his people calm so they can concentrate on the game.
Yeah, it's absolutely super important. But let's talk about their opponents. We have TCM going straight into the School Bus head on. These team are also veterans, been around from different teams, collecting together, but mostly based in Germany. But one of the players who came over from TCM was Eurofish, wasn't it? Well, Eurofish was one of the big players that came over from TCM.
Spale. Yeah, Eurofish came from Spale. He's my teammate in RSOP, also my countryman. So he's really calm person, and I think he's gonna do really great. He's the MVP of the Powered by Razer. So he has been playing really good the whole season, doing the damage. But of course, sometimes he might be a bit too aggressive, and he must pay the cost at that times. But
okay, well, let's meet Eurofish and the rest of TCM.
For us, it was a lot of time. We were training every day, and it was like three last weeks we just spent with training every single evening. So always when we get back from work, we get on the computers and practice to get as much preparation as possible before these offlines.
At this moment in DCM, we have three different team captains basically in the team. It can be a challenge at sometimes, but I think it's a big benefit to us overall because we have so many ideas flying around in trainings and stuff like that.
We're just thinking what to do because on the last event in DreamHack, we, I think, put the stuff really on the high level, but we came up with some really brilliant ideas, so stay tuned and be ready for some crazy stuff tomorrow on the stage.
Some crazy stuff tomorrow, they said. Well, tomorrow is now today. We're going to find out very shortly if TCM can bring it. So let's go and talk about their players again. Yorfish, the guy you say coming from Spell, has the world on his shoulders right now. You said that sometimes he may be a little bit more aggressive than he needs to be. Let's elaborate on that.
He likes to be the MVP of the game. So he likes to take the spots, play a bit too aggressive at sometimes, but that's the risk you have to take because sometimes it pays off and you can win the game by the spots he gets, so it's like high risk, high reward, and sometimes it pays off, sometimes it doesn't. So
we need to keep an eye on this guy, and if he is going ahead being really aggressive, if he gets taken out, it might spell the doom of TCM, or at least be a really big setback for them, but if he somehow survives, they might be doing very well. So TCM's guy to look out for is Yorfish himself. So
sure.
The rest of TCM, though, very native to Germany, most of them, or at least half the team, are German-based.
Yes, half of the team is German. They are in the team since season one, I think, and the others are allocated from the other teams. They like change teams. So Uralfish came from Spiel, as we talked, and he can now concentrate on his game. He was leading, so he's now just focusing on the game, but still gets more impact with the tactical decisions. Mojo was switched from Kasna to them, and he's also like head of the team with Tauros. So the decision-making is pretty great.
They do have a lot of ability to work well as a team, but that's enough of the teams. Let's look at their actual battles. We go into the map picking. Now, we have something special going on as they're flipping the coin. We are going to, here on the analysis desk, make predictions ourselves of what the result will be. The experts will be handing me their cards with the prediction on. We'll go through after the match how well they went. So you guys, as the map picking is going on, please start making your predictions as we see that TCM get to pick first of which map to ban. And we'll find out which map it is. Which map do you think is going to be banned the most? Which?
For sure, I think the most banned maps in the whole tournament will be Steps, Ruinberg and Prokhorovka, in that order. So
we expect Ruinberg to be a second ban. Do you agree with that, Carmen?
I think that Prokhorovka will be banned more because Ruinberg can always, teams try to get it as a fifth map and, you know, just camp there. But already, if I'm right, we already doesn't have Steps and doesn't have Ensk.
Yes,
so it's pretty surprising.
Pretty surprising, yeah. You said that Ensk you didn't expect to be taken out. Why? Why is Ensk such a good map? Or is it just that Steps is such a risky map?
For me, Ensk is one of the city maps and also have this open area. You can pretend attack very well and you also can defend it. It's not like in Ruinberg, you have one spot and it's really, really good for them. But we must remember that it's a grand finals rule, so plus one after each draw. So we maybe have only one, only see three maps. So almost for sure we'll see Cliffs, and maybe Mice, and maybe Prokhorovka. So quite surprising, Prokhorovka is fifth. Yeah, Wilkie, quite surprising.
Well, Himmelsdorf comes in second. That means Ruinberg is the first map. Any surprises there for Ruinberg coming up on top?
Well, leaving Ruinberg to the last map, or the fourth map, is really risky, because if the other team is on head, on the Ruinberg, they can go to the K1 camp, or H1 camp, and that is really hard to defuse. So you want to get the Ruinberg on the start, so you can play it out, and then start playing for real. It's just way too hard to defuse the Ruinberg camp if the other team is ahead of you.
Right, so it's going to be one of those maps that it's Southspawn will have an advantage, and they will probably play defensive. Although we have seen many teams trying to break that camp. Fnatic actually contacted me from the North American scene saying that they expect camping on Ruinberg South, and they know how to break it. They have a strategy that is flawless. It's going to always work.
Of course, teams are training how to defuse the camp. It's something they have to do because that the South strategy is usually camping in the corner. So you have to know how to defuse it, or at least try to defuse it.
And there is the school bus uniforms. And yes. I think we haven't actually mentioned them right now, but I did go up to them when we first saw and said, okay, let me guess. This is an arts project, a children's art project. And they were like, yes, school bus arts project. This is exactly what we're going for. So if you think, what are they doing wearing these T-shirts that look like an art project that 12-year-olds would have drawn, that is the whole point.
Yeah, this homemade. We thought that from a moment they will, you know, toss it from kindergarten or something like that. But to mention about the game, I'm really hoping to see something different on Ruinberg. Maybe something aggression. And also remember that camp can be broken. Esuba broke Kuraki, and that's why Kuraki are not here. So
on Ruinberg South.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons why camping there is not that good idea from time to time. I think really, really important first game, who also you must remember, if you are going to Sand River, the damage on the map is deciding. So it's really important to make the shells, to find the shells, and to make the damage. Just waiting, just hoping. Look at the guys, they're stressed. They don't, you know. It's first game of the season, so.
Well, we will see. School Bus and TCM, both veterans of the scene, they are very, very talented players. Very calm, very experienced. And experience, as we just said before, with Snitzel, it's super important that you are prepared for the offline scene. The offline scene is a lot more, what's the way to put it? I believe it was yourself, Carmen, that said to me that you never know whether you're going to have a stomachache or you're going to be distracted or you left something at home that you normally have with you. It's just different.
You must remember that you have different settings of the computer. No matter what computer, it's always calm to have your own computer, your own keyboard. You have to be, you know, prepared that you will not feel well. The degree of the, you know, the monitor can be different. The monitor can have, you know, different resolution. It's all the time some details which are, you know, then making of the victory or not. Especially on this level, especially on this game where it's so to the players and so to also to some random generator. But you must, you know, try to avoid the random generator and win it by the best.
Like in poker, you got to maximize your chances. Yeah. It doesn't matter about that sort of stuff. So let's talk about this exact matchup in the past. Who's got the edge statistically between School Bus and TCM? They've fought a lot of times.
I think School Bus has the advantage there in statistically speaking, in winning more than losing against TCM. But they didn't fight this team several times, so I think it's still an even matchup.
They could surprise us. They did say they are trying for new tactics. TCM are going to pull out some different stuff with 11 players here because they are local. They have fought their full team. Do you expect to see something different?
I hope that TCM can bring something new because, like I said, School Bus is more seasoned team, so I think they're gonna win this match, but we shall see.
We will see if TCM can pull it out. We do think, though, that they are really a bit of the underdogs. They are the guys that not really everyone is expecting too much from. The sixth place was really hard fought. It could have been many, many different teams that could be there. It was really close in the league. And this is why, as you see the stats being revealed of all the different teams as the event goes on, you'll notice that many of them are very, very, very close. It's all about your teamwork. It's all about the accuracy of your players to be in that moment shooting straight and the decision-making of your captains to make sure the tanks are at the right place at the right time. But as School Bus said, they're not really centralized. It's individual players. They're okay, we know what we're doing, do it. Now, will that be their downfall? The fact that they're all acting individually, or will they be, you know, better off individual?
I think it's completely different School Bus than we saw in any other season because it's no more Stalker. It's not the one guy deciding where they should go and blaming for any mistake. They are bitter, more, you know, relaxed. Without the Stalker, also they know better about money, better about other stuff, internal stuff. I think this will, you know, this is also a new start, a new kickoff. They have the experience, but it's a new kickoff for them. Really waiting for what they will show in this game.
Well, yes, no one can say they cannot be super interested in what Schoolbus are going to pull out, because it is a different team. But anyway, it is time to meet your casters of the weekend. Some call her Pansy and her right-hand man, Laughter.
That's much better, Dorjan. Thank you very much. And obviously, thank you very much to the analysis desk and Mitch and Melly there. Great start to the show and a great start to the offline finals. And what a game to start with. TCM up against Schoolbus, two teams that are pretty prolific in their own ways. And we were discussing this a little bit before where we were going live, is the difference in styles. But they're actually fairly similar in some ways here, aren't they?
Yeah, they're pretty similar that they don't really have a centralized command point.
Yeah.
You know, TCM have a lot of commanders. You got Eurofish on your screens there. He was the commander of Spalla, of course. You know, you got Thoris, who's really the guy which we kind of go to say, okay, this guy's kind of captaining
right,
TCM.
Okay.
But then we've got Steel Mojo, an ex-commander of Kazna crew. So they got
solid
all these
input,
kind of guys.
Yeah.
Solid input, exactly. And then on the side of Schoolbus, you just heard in the video that they don't really have a central command either. Yeah, okay, Arklet has got a cool head on his shoulders and he's going to be kind of pushing things forwards a little bit. But it's all in all a kind of a spread out thing. And first map, Ruhenberg, it's going to be interesting, as you know, Carmen said. It's going to be about if the team does decide to camp in that corner.
Yeah, a lot of options available to these two teams. Varying styles we've seen on Ruhenberg from season to season. Previously, that head-on-head clash just up the Crescent Moon kind of aggression with the T69 to 3090s in play, that kind of became less favorable. And we saw other styles coming through. What can we expect from these two teams? Because you could argue Schoolbus is a city map kind of based team. They have that strength there. But as does TCM to an extent, they're very similar in that aspect. What can we expect from them both now?
You can expect a little bit of aggression. You can expect a little bit of, you know, just pushing forwards into the right positions and trying to get themselves into an early advantage. And once they've got themselves there, it's going to be very interesting. And how they can move out once they are in that position is going to be the real key element of these two. You can see a school bus heading up towards the eastern village and TCM heading towards the city.
Yeah, so a little bit of a difference in start, but nothing too major just yet. Already, though, Tier 1 has been lost. Thoros did find Deadhunter. So already a small advantage to CCM, but nothing too much just yet. And is Applewow on a limb here, or is he almost being bait, do you think?
He's in the normal position. You know, he spotted the middle area with the AMX 1390s. He's got a lot of cover by the Armaly and Shanish. You know, Shanish is probably the guy who does the most damage throughout the whole season. In fact, Schoolbus is top dealing damage dealer altogether. Mm. Playing that AMX 5100 a lot does give you that edge. You know, if you're playing a 5100, you can often get more damage than a guy who's playing an AMX 1390 by default. But he is, after Applewow, the second best player, in my opinion. So, you know, no discredit to him at all. But neither of these two teams have actually gone for a camp. TCM are in towards the city. You can see they haven't gone to the K and J area. And Schoolbus in the eastern village, kind of culminating their forces a little bit now. Armaly and Shanish have taken a little bit of damage, but not a lot, and nothing to really write home about.
Yeah, so not a completely passive start, but not complete aggression just yet. But both teams seem to be trying to make a small move in their own regards, kind of rotating around the map almost in a bit of a clockwise fashion. So obviously TCM in blue, who started in the south, have kind of got themselves in towards that city, whereas Schoolbus in red have gone towards the eastern village, as you noted, kind of just rotating around each other. Now, is there a position you prefer in this? Is there an advantageous kind of spot? Because I don't think the Schoolbus will be able to connect any shots because they've already crossed TCM. They're already towards the north of the map. Who's in the better spot here? Who's being more aggressive?
TCM are being a little bit more aggressive. Whereas Schoolbus are in the standard position, although they're now heading back towards the base. TCM have got themselves quite far into the village. Yeah, they got those T1s, those AMX 1390s, Thoris and Eurofish. In the kind of CB area. That's just to put them into the cap if they want to. You've got the rest of the tanks rotating around now from Schoolbus because they know that TCM likes to go for that cap. They know they like to try and put the pressure on in multiple positions. But then again, Ruhenberg is a very hard map to win. It's quite polarized. You know, you can see straight away Schoolbus have got the village, TCM have got the city. And it's really about how you kind of play your tanks towards the environment that can give you an advantage. We've seen teams like Lucky Cracky push up in towards the village from the southern area. We've seen trying to fast caps happen, but altogether the kind of derpy tactics only work once, and neither of these two teams really want to be doing those derpy tactics. Maybe a little bit later in the tournament when they kind of have to bring something special, that's when we'll see those kind of tactics come out.
Yeah, and I do want to ask you a question. Obviously, we have 6 minutes still in this one, so a lot of time to play with, but
In other games, generally, you may argue that a more defensive side may have the advantage, but sometimes you've got to take into account you're still a little bit, you know, you're not warmed up yet, you're still very new to this, you're still very new to the stage, to the atmosphere. Surely sometimes making that first move might actually be a good idea. It gets you warmed up, you're a little bit more leading of the pace. And who's kind of leading that more here? Would you argue TCM? They've seemed to make a small push towards the city area. They've retracted back. And it just looks like School Bus is playing the kind of responsive game rather than trying to make their own move so far, to me.
Yeah, that's actually, I was quite surprised that, you know, the analysis desk said that TCM's a reactive team. I disagree completely. I think they're always changing things up. They're always trying to make something happen. And they've actually kind of caught Eurofish a little bit, Applewhite even a little bit. Eurofish connecting the first shot, and Applewhite has to get out there.
Yeah, this was a big question. Eurofish and Applewhite, two-star players, both of that little bit of ego there that you need to be able to make these shots land. And Applewhite being forced back, he does have some support here. Has Eurofish once again let that ego get to him, or will he play it safe? Niyu is just around that corner in the village. You can see him just playing smart. The rest of TCM are now catching up. A good amount of damage was dealt towards Applewhite. Was that maybe a little bit too much out of place from Applewhite there? Is he too low, or was that okay for the information gathered?
Well, Deadhunter going down via Thorist was actually quite a big blow because they couldn't keep the Tier 1 and K0, which is a very important point because it does allow you to keep map dominance, you know, map control, which is a key word you'll hear a lot this weekend. You know, keeping eyes on all corners of the map, and that's really what you want from those Tier 1s. So him going down was kind of disastrous. So Apwar losing, you know, almost 500 HP is a pretty big deal. Armley's already taken a shell. Shanishi's almost already taken a shell. So that's pretty much one Tier 8 tank down in terms of damage, and Niyu's next.
Still wait to see if they can find a bit of reply. Only Eurofish really taking a bit of a beating, but Niyu is in trouble. He's going quite low and doesn't really have an escape to this one. Needs to be a little bit more careful. TCM a little bit reluctant to go for that full commitment, and right to be so. Schoolbus are waiting for that full-on push, and TCM still looking for the pickup of a kill. As you said, a gun in the game is still just, you know, as big as anything that you could imagine, because even if they're low on HP, they can still do that damage. So Niyu just needs to play safe, play smart, and stay alive in this one more than anything.
Yeah, gun in the game is most important. Yes, okay, you know, Schoolbus has taken a lot of damage, but TCM have got Eurofish pretty much on one shot, and Niyu go solo.
Yeah, I don't think you can get out of this one. No, indeed, Yizni does come around the side, and still Mojo was there in case the shot did not land, and that's now two tanks down for Schoolbus. Armley, Shanish, Arklit, and Applewhite, joined by Dark God Zim, obviously, will have to pull themselves back into this one. But so far, TCM looked pretty clinical. Let's be very serious. They spotted the weak link, and they've tried to abuse it, and they've done just that. Applewhite, also low. Armley taking a big bit of damage. They're not looking too good so far.
Yeah, that's the thing. From the south, if you actually do manage to get in towards the village, it's awesome. You've got a lot of good positions to sit around. You've got a lot of bushes. But the thing is, it's actually getting to that village that's the hard part. And that's what TCM did correctly. They got there. And now they've taken down Niyu. He's playing that Orc at AMX 5100. Great for doing damage. Not so good if you want to sit behind the house because it's pretty much as big as a house. So it's really, really disaster. Still Mojo now going forwards. This is clinical from TCM. He's got the most HP. He's got the most armor. Yizni in the background with that AMX 5100 provide that firepower. Shanish the one to receive it.
Well, here we go. Shanish will be on the front lines. He gets one shell coming in from Still Mojo. Yizni comes in to deal that damage. Still Mojo not really helping out much here. Finally turns that turret, and Shanish will fall to Yizni. So already two kills back to back. Wizenny is picking up both of them. And now this just puts Schoolbus in a terrible position. They've lost their big guns in the game, excluding Armley. Arklit's still there, but completely out of the fight. And Applewhite's being caught, trying to find cover. Just about makes it away on 27 HP. But in the meantime, Arklit is in severe trouble, already taken so low. This looks like a map win for TCM, unless somehow Schoolbus pulls one out. But Arklit tracked, held, caught. One more shell will put him to bed. And surely that's going to be delivered very soon. I don't know how he's alive here. Normally, still not into the battle. Thoris should deal the final blow towards Arklit.
Should is the word.
Oh, wow. Another
but so many
bounce.
Bounces, yeah.
There we go. Finally, Eurofish will do the job. And every single member of Schoolbus is accounted for, has been found. And this is just a matter of time now.
Yeah, this is execution. It was game over pretty much when TCM took down Niyu. That was the hard part done. And I would have to argue the hard part was actually getting into that village in the first place. Still Mojo, I think he receives a little bit of team damage then, but none the better for Schoolbus, and bounces that shot on Armley.
Galore.
I mean, come on, guys. You got to be hitting those shots. You can't turn into Denali Sports. Sorry, Carmen. But he's going to play Ring of Ring of Roses. But I guess game over. 1 minute and 43 seconds left. Plenty of time for Applewhite to go down. Not so MVP right now. Jurofish seems to be the one doing
how
all the jobs
Amelie
for the Amelie alive? Yeah. Yizni will do it, though. I don't know how he lives. He's just got too much armor.
If Abuwal stays alive, it'd be a miracle. But nothing's connecting. Finally, Jurofish does the job. First map goes to TCM. But those bounces were real. That was unfathomable. But even outside of that, outside of the RNG factor to an extent, let's look at what actually happened in the tactics in a way there and how it kind of broke down a little bit. Because TCM looked like they had a plan and they executed it.
They did exactly that. It was so beautiful to see. And that's what is great, a great thing about TCM. They are capable of these incredible tactics. They basically use School Bus's normal tactics against them. So they pushed themselves up in towards the north side of the city. School Bus saw it. They rotated to try and deal with that in case TCM went for the standard kind of rush into the cap. Then once TCM knew that School Bus was up there, they just did it based on timing. They didn't get any spots. They actually just rotated immediately around using those double AMX 1390 speed to get up north into K0 and then push into the city because only Apowai was there spotting because they didn't have that tier one. So they didn't have enough tanks to actually deal with a push along the road with the bushes. So yeah, just pulling School Bus into places they don't want to be at, then exploiting that to the max near you with that awkward AMX 5100 went down. And then pretty much there on out, it was just a slippery slope. School Bus couldn't get back from there. And with the whole rule set we've got, you know, it's not best
one map win is huge.
It's not really even best of five. I mean, yeah, of course there's five maps, but you get plus one if you get a win. You get plus one if you get a draw. Both teams get one. You get zero if you get a loss. So at the moment, TCM, all they have to do is basically hang on for this best of five, and they'll be able to get the win because, you know, they're 1-0 up.
Yeah, simple as that. If you did watch the grand finals not too long ago, obviously a phenomenal tournament there. We'll be using the same rule set. So if you're familiar with that, you will be able to keep up. We'll be reminding you throughout the entire show just to keep you up to date. But at the moment, no matter what rules they were using, TCM are leading. They looked very strong. They looked very comfortable as well. They didn't look shaken. They didn't look nervous. They looked solid as hell. Let's be really serious about that. Because on paper, School Bus are the better team. Better results, more seasoned veterans, you might argue. They've got star player power in Apowai and many others in that team. Let's be very honest about that. But in that situation, TCM outplayed them, and that's dangerous. And let's also look at it this way. That was TCM's map choice in a way. Next map is Himmelsdorf now coming up. So Himmelsdorf is a map that is sensationally strong for School Bus, but also another good point, actually, for TCM. It's not a weak map for them. It's still a very good map. But would you say it's as good as School Bus's?
Well, the thing is, when TCM and School Bus fought each other in the season, it was pretty much the middle. It was still when TCM had the good results on Winter's Himmelsdorf. But towards the end of the season, they started losing it more and more. Although, you know, it's still their best map statistically. They got to be careful on it. They won against School Bus, though, so they've got that going for them. But it's really one of those maps which is so balanced that you can't really say, okay, this team's going to win it, this team's going to lose it, just based on what we've seen on the online stage. Any team can win it on any day. It's really an extraordinary map like that. So many tactics, so many variations. But I have to say, what TCM have been doing on the online stage, they've been trying new things, they've been analyzing teams, they've been, you know, showing us tactics we've never seen before. It kind of reminds me of Kazan and Spala when they were duking out on Himmelsdorf in the previous seasons. I think they have the edge on that. School Bus haven't been innovating, they've been kind of sitting back, being kind of defensive, and they kind of paid for it.
They have indeed, but I find it always very hard to doubt School Bus on this map. It's something they've always impressed me on. You know, against Virtus Pro, you saw Virtus Pro being not necessarily tested as hard as expected, but they still were shaken by School Bus. You could see them certainly considering that and certainly playing it very, very drawn out style. But we also have to take the fact now that TCM are up a point. So going forward, they may not be as willing to make that first move. School Bus may now be forced to have to go for that slightly more aggressive, we must win this play, whereas TCM could draw this map out and still be in a good position leading with that map point. Now, if you're TCM in this situation, if that's you right there sitting on the screen, would you then play a little more passively? Because there's always that danger, though, isn't there, that if you play passively, you could just get overrun. But would this be the time to slow down, or is this still a map where you can challenge?
What's quite nice is that TCM won that game based on what they did as opposed to reacting. But they've also got that reactionary play the analyst at desk was talking about, which they can fall back on, which is great for them because on Himmelsdorf, it is a good map for reactionary play. You can kind of see what the other team's doing. You know, are they going on the hill? Are they pushing around? What are we going to do when this team does that? And you can kind of just go through the map like that. Whereas School Bus, you know, 1-0 down, they got to bring out something like TCM did on Roomberg, which can actually win the map, which is harder because you're playing a game that can react to those situations, that can have the players to pick it up when they're down. And you know, Eurofish, such a fantastic example. When he's under pressure in that AMX 5100, he will perform. It doesn't matter if it's 1v1, doesn't matter if it's 3v1, he'll always be there and hitting those shots. He loves those situations.
Let's also kind of break down the tanks we're going to see, because we didn't see much innovation during any of the offline finals previously to now, because obviously offline finals is a big moment. You can see Himmelsdorf on your screens right there. It's the most standardized city map you're ever going to see, pretty much. It is the defining one. Will there be any variations, or will this be down to the ground, your basic world of tanks picked on this map?
I think there's going to be some variation. Obviously, you know, School Bus do want to win it. It depends if they actually have a good tactic on this one. They've still got a few maps to play around with. They don't have to worry too much. And TCM, they would risk a lot by being aggressive and going forward. So if I was TCM, I would sit back, relax, and just try and go for more of a standardized tactic. But they do surprise, and sometimes TCM don't seem to have, you know, the most logical way of playing the game, and especially when they're up. So that could always be a bad thing. But Apple going immediately aggressive along that two line, just going to be trying to get a couple of cross shots off, see what TCM's doing.
Yeah, so School Bus will be starting in the south in red and TCM in the north in blue, leading with one map under their belt so far. So we could expect a slightly more passive TCM, but they're not quite doing the full-on turtle towards the northwest side that we do see coming out quite some few times. But then again, I probably wouldn't want to play it against School Bus, who used to do that tactic themselves quite some bit. So already at the moment, it looks like School Bus just taking their time. We are seeing a little bit of a nod towards that strategy. The camera work is making me possibly have a seizure, but there we go. It's calmed down. Yizni and Eurofish will be sitting up there. So this is what we kind of discussed and predicted, the slightly more passive style of TCM, but not completely turtled down.
Yeah, they're not 100%. You know, Yizni, Eurofish keeping the four line, making sure that School Bus aren't going for a quick aggression up the 1-2-3 line. And they got enough firepower to deal with it, and at least enough firepower to inflict enough damage onto School Bus that when the rest of TCM does rotate around, they can actually, you know, take down the tanks. And Dark God Zim doing a good job of spotting Devil. Not so much resources on the hill for TCM. A couple down the bottom, DJ Red Deep in that AMX 5100. And I've got to say it, for AMX 5100 from TCM Gaming, an interesting pickup. They don't often do that. I don't think they've done it in the whole online stage, no. Maybe like once, which is really a peculiar thing. Usually, if you want to go defensive and you're kind of up, you want to be taking the defensive tanks, which can kind of thwart off a lot of damage, which can, you know, help you in those situations. Devil going forward to try and, you know, put some pressure against Dark God Zim. But a lot of teams do like to go for this hill play at the beginning and then rotate around immediately. But School Bus have got four of their combat tanks towards the left side, so obviously that's going to be the side they go for.
So 7 minutes into finding out who will go with this map. At the moment, it is down to School Bus now to make the plays happen. Last time, they were the more reactive side. They weren't necessarily leading the pace like TCM were happy to do. And at the moment, School Bus will have to find their way into this. It looks like maybe a 1-3 line presence, but nothing fast, nothing haphanded. It has to be clinical. TCM will not let this one slip, and there is that danger of the burst fire just coming out from those 5100s. They are not an easy tank to deal with. But still, they still have the IS-3 in the hands of Thoros there, so nothing too one-sided, but still, School Bus certainly with a well more rounded lineup there with the two IS-3s, but still. The moment near you is making his way forward. He does have some backup coming down that three line. So still slightly passive play from TCM. Not really making much of a move. They're keeping most of their eyes on the east side of the map, but we are seeing a little bit of a nudge across that D line, but nothing too much. And at the moment, I think School Bus are fairly unspotted, but you've got to say TCM surely know where this is going to be coming from if there is going to be an attack.
Well, for sure, they've got three tanks committed there. They know that School Bus like that 1-3 line push, and to be honest, it's the best push you can do from the south. You know, yeah, okay, Virtus Pro and for some extent, Navi from the Russian region like to go up the 8 line, the banana road, as some people call it, but this is really the most reliable. So we've got Steelmojo, Yizni, Eurofish all just ready and waiting. Yes, okay, 4 combat tanks are going forward for School Bus, so they got more damage, more firepower, more HP. But, you know, the kind of positioning TCM have, they've got Steelmojo on the cross, Yizni, Eurofish on surprise attack, I guess. It's good. You'll be able to get the first couple of shells off, so you can kind of thwart that one tank advantage. You've also got Thoris, the team captain, waiting up the D line, so he can try and get some shots on if Arklit and Apple Owl, for instance, try and go for a cap, which is looking like what they want to do. Dead Hunters there in the tier one. You've got the firepower with the M6400 ISS3 to try and take down any tanks to try and stop that cap. So often we've seen that, you know, the classic tier ones in the cap and the tanks sitting up around making sure they don't do it. But Boris eventually connects the shell and DJ Reggie playing hill as well. So again, TCM have every answer.
And Scorbus, I'm not sure why they're backing away from this. And I'm not sure why Armley took that route. Maybe just a little bit. I don't know. It's a dangerous route to take. If you're going to make that cross, there's always going to be at least one tank there, generally towards that 6 line around the D line as well. It's generally in that position, just watching over mid. Armley taking that route, if he's not willing to make a shot, is just a little bit haphanded, to my taste. He's been hit, you know, he's already taken a bit of damage. They're now falling back passively. And Scorbus can't really afford this. Let's bear in mind, TCM won't lose anything from drawing out. They're still very happy here, just sitting there with that one win so far. And I remember the grand finals discussion of if you win one map, you're pretty much in good stead. Still, 4 minutes on the board, a lot of time to work with. Scorbus do need to kind of consolidate themselves. It looks like they are rotating around the map and looking for another way in.
Yeah, heading up the hill, Apwow near you, Shanish. They got 350-100s, a lot of speed. They've spotted Devil up there already, and they can kind of guess because Thoris down is down below that really TCM can't have too much. They also kind of thinking, okay, TCM must be defending the base in some way, shape, or form. So I'm kind of surprised they didn't just push around to Yizni and Eurofish because, you know, having spotted a lot of Thoris and DJ Red deep, you kind of think, well, if there's 2, we can go 4 against 2, and really, regardless, you're going to win that matchup. But he doesn't look like he wants to go for it entirely, sending Dark Lord to him first. You don't want to get spotted in this situation because really TCM would react perfectly, come around and take them down. But yeah, we kind of predicted. TCM have been staying very defensive, reacting to what Schoolbus is doing, and Schoolbus have been trying to get themselves into the map. And at first trying the 1-3 line didn't work because of the cross, and then trying the hill with a lot of tanks. And often, you know, having this hill tactic kind of works, but it does put you out of position on the rest of the map, especially if you put a lot of resources.
Look at the rotate kind of from TCM. I think they're well aware now of what is coming up on that hill. Eurofish already moving across with Steelmojo. Magus and Thoris looking for a response as well. And TCM seeming to be able to read this like a book. Armley and Arklit going to struggle to find an easy way through here, and TCM just finding the responses perfectly. The tier one left on the other side of the map, I believe that was Dead Hunter, should be getting a little bit of a face full of damage. There we go, Yizni will deliver that, and already tier one lost again, but at least they know TCM are making a move. But still, Schoolbus looking a little bit slow on the rotate, a little bit slow on the push off, but they're gonna get there. But is it a little too late? Because TCM are already waiting.
Yeah, Arklit, Armley are in a good position though, and as you said, TCM have done the perfect thing of just getting themselves into the kind of defensive area near their cap. The tier ones are slightly out of position, so you've got to be careful. A little bit of damage connecting onto them, 613. So TCM a little bit caught out, and at the moment, Schoolbus definitely have the advantage because I think Eurofish is out of position, trying to rotate, trying to get himself into a better place behind Schoolbus, but that's dangerous, and the analysis desk were talking about that. If Eurofish plays too aggressive, plays on his own too much, it could be disastrous.
Yeah, certainly going to be a factor here. I think the tier one's going to spot him up pretty damn soon as well. So they should be aware they can get the overmatch by the cap if they fancy it. Yizni missing the shell. And, well, a little bit lacking so far, but it looks like Schoolbus is starting to edge through. I think they're going to try and take down Eurofish and then just go for the rest. Why not go 1v5 if you fancy it? There's only 1 minute and 35 seconds left. They need to kind of eliminate every single factor here if they want this. Eurofish is being closed in on. Applewow will be the first to charge in. Dark God Zim, tier one behind him. Shanish near you and Armley there. Eurofish will now be met. He's
A little lower on HP for Applewell. Doesn't get the best shot possible, and Applewell's actually taking a bit of damage now. Eurofish can do well in these situations. Let's bear that in mind. And Applewell in a 1v1, and this is sloppy stuff from Schoolbus, leaving Applewell just on his own to challenge against Eurofish. Finally, Shanish comes in, but takes a shell. Eurofish back and forth. Look at the damage he is causing here, and the cross is being made hard work by the likes of Still Mojo, but now Eurofish in a 1v2 still, having to be cautious, having to be careful, but Schoolbus just not finding the execution, and they're running out of time.
Yeah, they really have only 51 seconds to make something happen, and look how many tanks have taken damage. Apple definitely a one-shot. Shanish a possible one-shot for an IS3, but very unlikely. Well, pretty likely, actually. 390 average damage is pretty much going to go down 100%. And also the cap's coming on the way from Schoolbus, and this is their last chance.
This is it, and Thoros is there. The IS3 has that defensive position near you, finally takes down Devil, but let's bear in mind, Still Mojo and Co. are falling back. Armley finds Dejuri deep, and this is going a little better, but the time is of the essence, and 21 seconds is not enough. Surely they're going to struggle here. The vast majority of players up is for Schoolbus, but at the moment, it doesn't look like it's going to matter. Yizni finally takes down Applewell, who was desperately low. And as we speak, the clock is looking like the biggest factor here, and I think it's too little too late for both of these teams.
Yeah, it's going to be a draw. TCM managed to hang on, although Schoolbus did do a lot of damage. Look, 4 combat tanks against 2. But it was kind of predicted by TCM. They knew that it would take a lot of damage because Schoolbus did a perfect push around. But at the end of the day, a draw is what TCM wanted, and that's exactly what they got. So that's more of a victory for them than a victory for Schoolbus.
And it was Eurofish who was stuck in the middle of the map then in the 5100, was it? If I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it was, yeah.
Now, why on earth did they leave Applewell just to 1v1 him when Applewell had already taken damage for Schoolbus and then didn't give him support from the form of Shanish until halfway through the little engagement? And They were caught up by him for such a long time. They were unable to actually support back with the push. Was this just maybe a lacking cause, a little bit of lack of communication, or what do you think broke down there? Because it must have been an issue, because they initially targeted him and then kind of fumbled it a little.
I think it was more Apwile's call than anyone else's. I think he just went for it, thinking that he could win, or at least, you know, do a decent amount of damage so Armley in the background could actually come in and do the final blow he needed. So it was more of a calculated risk for Napwell. Didn't work out, but because Eurofish, you know, he had Armley to deal with as well, he didn't manage to take down Napwell. He had to reverse. He could only make the last shell he needed against Armley. Did a good amount of damage. But, you know, it was back and forth between those two. And I have to say, Eurofish did a good job there altogether. Stayed alive for a very long time. Yeah, he did get taken down in the end, but he kind of distracted Schoolbus for a while.
And considering people often put him out there as one of the more ego players, he'll go for those shots consistently, he'll try and play for that. To play with the amount of discipline he did just to buy time, to slow him down, to keep those two completely locked into that 1v2 situation when really those two could have been used at that cap, it could have been a big difference. So well done to him. Keeping his nerves calm, keeping himself with the right mentality going into this. So at the moment, if I'm not mistaken, it's still TCM leading, but there is still 1 point now in the camp of Schoolbus with the draw factor coming. So it should be a 2-1 still in favor to TCM. So map next is Cliff. Not sure about TCM on this map. I'm trying to kind of look back at how it went down. This is a TCM choice. How have they performed on Cliff throughout the season?
TCM have done a pretty good job on Cliff. It's been back and forwards a little bit. They've tried a few interesting tactics, but it's been, you know, a mediocre map. The same kind of goes for Schoolbus. They've only won a few games. I think it's about 33% of the games they've won it. So I guess they've been, you know, kind of struggling a little bit. They did well at the beginning. You know, they have that Pershing tactic, but, you know, that Pershing doesn't seem to supply enough damage to deal with a team that wants to push over through the middle. Also, a good point to remember is that the online phase was played on the old Cliff. We're now playing on 9.2, which
with
is the new Cliff.
With the addition of the village and other small parts to it,
exactly.
Right?
You've got the northern the northern village, exactly what you're talking about. Also, from the south and the north, you can push up through along the bottom and head up towards that middle rock a lot quicker. But the thing is, from the north, I think it has more of an advantage now because you can shoot basically the southern guy who wants to push up towards that lighthouse. You know, you've got that hill you can kind of spot over. From the south, now you can just get shots constantly because of the changes to the village. So, you know, very, very interesting thing if these two teams are going to be able to counter that. What team has kind of come up with a good tactic to you know, adapt to the map? That's going to be the most important thing. And you've got to remember as well, not all that much training could have happened. Yeah, okay, these guys have been playing a long time, but it's more about just getting used to the map, not only in training battles, also in random battles.
Yeah, and at the moment, I've got to say, TCM look like they've done their homework a little more than Skullbus. Obviously, Ruinberg being a bit of a factor of that one, the way they played that out was absolutely beautiful. Knowing how Skullbus played it and played it just a little better than themselves. Dangerous game to play, obviously, but they pulled it off well. Himmelsdorf, something very similar as well. They read the play perfectly. They look like they've done their homework, and I'm hoping we can see that here on Cliff coming up next. And in your prediction, is this going to be near on the final map for us?
I think it could be. TCM have got that ability just to try new things, and it often works. So Cliff is something that can go for their favour. And as I was saying, the inexperience of these teams could also help them out. But again, it's risky for them if they do go for something and Skullbus manages to counter it. You know, you don't want to have a 2-2 situation. You just want to be going through the next couple of maps just with a draw for TCM, definitely. And I think, you know, as your kind of basic, you want to be flanking, trying something, and then going back to the defensive tactic again. So you still have the option of doing something if you see a way in, but you don't necessarily have to take it.
So as you can see, Cliff on your screens there, fairly open. Good amounts of cover, however. Maybe not as open as your Steps or your Prokhorovka. It has those options there, and there we go. TCM up against Skullbus. The lineups you've been watching so far at the moment, TCM just coming off way better. So in the south, in red, it will be Skullbus with everything to do, pretty much. And TCM in the north, in blue, providing us with a stellar performance so far. And is there any surprises to the tank lineups we're seeing, or is this something fairly normal?
Well, I expected one of these two teams to kind of push along the bottom and go for that quick hill push so you can actually, for instance, from the south, get shots onto the team that goes north. But because TCM have got such a fast lineup, that is impossible.
So
good
mirrored?
Thinking from them. Yeah, it's quadruple.
It's very Russian style. After watching the Russian finals, they all seem to go for 1390s. Is this a knock-on effect, do you reckon?
Yeah, it could be. I think it just might be also the changes to the map that just make it a lot more adaptable when you use those fast AMX 1390s. And immediately we see Skullbus try and go for the attack. But look at that, near you taking a lot.
Yeah, he's in trouble. He's been focused down immediately. A little bit of fire comes in towards Arklet and Apple as well, but Eurofish has been caught out. The fire going back and forth. Arklet is down low, 46 HP. He needs to back out of here. One more shell will put him down. Niyu does find Eurofish. So finally, Skullbus do have a one-player advantage. Thoris now probably next on the chopping board, down to 68 HP. He's in a little bit of trouble. Yizni as well. This is a far better execution from Skullbus, but the guns in the game stay true. Niyu claims DJ Redeep, and finally, Skullbus doing a bit of damage.
Yeah, but Still Mojo, I think he might be off freeload. Look how many tanks are taking damage for Skullbus. Still Mojo finally lands that shell onto Shani. He's trying to find Arklet next.
He needs to land this right now, otherwise the fire will be coming straight back in from Armaly and Applewell. Exactly what's going on. Applewell gets a little bit. Thoris finds Arklet. There we go, evening it back up. Two tanks lost, everything else in the game, but look at the HP pool. Thoris is an easy one-shot. Yizni probably the same, and Still Mojo is not exactly great either. This is a little bit worrying now for TCM.
Yeah, they've all on one shots at the moment. 309, yeah, probably not a one shot for a 240 average damage, as that AMX 1390 can do. Apar trying to get on the rotate, and I have to say, Skullbus just had the better execution there. The focus fire was better. Eurofish going down real early was the big key factor, because he couldn't actually get the reload and do the damage, and Skullbus just kept the tanks alive for a lot longer. And Thor, it's the next target for Skullbus. Armley has to go in, because he's got 847 to play around with, which is a plenty. Although, you know, he can get folks down pretty quickly. 7 minutes and 42 seconds, so plenty of time for Skullbus to try this Thoris trying to scamper out.
Apple actually missing a shot there. Not something I'm used to seeing. And a second, Thoris is somehow still alive. He wants to land the shell pretty damn quickly. You want to make sure you get in that full execution, riding that momentum forwards, but Apple out, missing the shots, backing away. He's renowned for his stunning play, but God only knows what will happen if he's off his game. Skullbus could start to struggle. But still, this will get them back tied up with TCM, and that's the danger. If you play for the draws the entire way through, there's always a chance someone like Skullbus can turn it around. So, at the moment, 7 minutes to find this execution. Three tanks on a one shot. Still Mojo took a little more damage as well, and then the tier ones. And I think Skullbus have got the map well enough covered that they're not going to really let a tier one slip anywhere. So I doubt it would be a draw. And it looks like they're trying to get that full push together to make sure no tier one slips past.
Yeah, they've got to keep their own tier ones in a good position to stop that, as you said, the tier one push. Because really, that's TCM's only option right now. actually try and go for the cap, but looking very impossible. Thoris is just trying to hang on in there. He is supported by Yizni. At the moment, Steel Mojo can't help him at all in that situation, so he's going to have to try and, you know, get himself into a better position. And for School Bus, it's just about finding their way in. How can they use Armley the most effectively to try and, you know, take the most damage, be in the best position? Then you can kind of creep Ahual and near you, where they can actually do the real main firepower. And for them, it's the, pushing around the lighthouse. Armley first, Ahual second, but Magus in a good position to deal with. But to be honest, even if they do get the early spots with the HP advantage School Bus has, it's not going to make a whole lot of difference.
Yeah, it looks almost inevitable, but School Bus are taking their time, respecting their opponent after those first two maps, clearly making sure everything is in place. Magus will be getting that alarm bell ringing very soon as Armley and Ahual will start to make their way forward. Magus, renowned for his tier one work, certainly a figure within the community, but let's see if maybe there's a response from TCM. As you said, it's a near on done deal, but Magus is doing the job. Armley's there looking for Thoris. They're trying to eliminate him from the picture. Leave it just then in the hands of Steel Mojo and Yizni need to do anything, but not finding an easy pick here, and TCM are making this hard work.
Well, of course, they're an incredible team. They're making it hard for School Bus, and they're going to really fight tooth and nail for this at the end of the day. This is really what they've been training for a long time, so there's no reason why they don't make it as hard as possible. Armley not looking like he wants to take the bait and go in. He kind of thinks, okay, the crossfire TCM could have, and with the advantage of the northern cover, he's not going to go for it. And Ahual landing a couple of shells to try and find himself onto Thoris, but Armley gets tracked immediately. Well, didn't get tracked, gets a few damaging shells towards him, but not a lot.
This is dangerous, though. You don't want to give them a chance here. They're a team, as you said, they're willing to scrap for this one. Ahual's not sitting too well either, but there we go. Finally, the kills come in. Near you and Ahual do claim them. Now, just Yizni and, well, Magus did stand, but now it's in a little bit of a troublesome situation as Yizni is the last man standing for TCM. This looks like a victory for School Bus here. Ahual, Armley heading out to hunt him down. And at the moment, you've got a feel for TCM. They just did not get into this map at all. Never found their footing, constantly on the back foot. And it looks like that final blow will be coming through pretty damn soon. Dead Hunter is there waiting. And he's going to get the spot on already. Ahual and Armley are moving in for the kill. 4 minutes on the board, they're going to get this one done. And this will bring us back all even. And that is a dangerous time. You don't want to give School Bus that momentum to build up. And here we go, Armley moving in. Lands it, and they get themselves back all even. School Bus picking up the third map here. Cliff finally being the map they get that win on.
Yeah, good initial damage. They knew that when it gets to the later game that perhaps the northern side will have a little bit more of an advantage. That's where they went for the early aggression. We have seen that push around the lower side of that defilade, along the lower side of that hill with the rocks on, quite a few times before, and it's been successful quite a few times before as well. Not to say that School Bus didn't do a good job, because they did a great job. Mm. They were kind of hotly contested at the beginning against TCM, but at the end of the day, you know, School Bus, they retracted their tanks at the better times. They didn't take so much damage, and that's really what gave them the advantage. Yes, TCM did a lot of damage at the beginning, more than School Bus did, but School Bus took down Eurofish, and that's made the big advantage in terms of the amount of firepower you could get out. We're always talking about that gun in the game. Mathematically gives you a huge step forwards in the right direction, and well, School Bus is a team that makes it work for them when they have that.
As you can see, next map coming up will be Mines, actually a pick from School Bus, which is dangerous in a way. They're a team that we've seen having hot and cold performances in offline events. So you look through the season finals, sometimes they have shone. And then we look at the grand finals, and it was atrocious for them. They barely made an appearance, and that's when the Stalker choice came in after that, and they moved on. But this looks a little bit like when they do have those struggling times. They're a little bit slow to warm up sometimes, a little slow to get in the tournament, but they're a team with that capability now, and you've got to think of it this way. If they've now just come off a win, you've almost got a smile there from Ahual, jeez. But Mines coming up, their choice of map, if their confidence is getting there, TCM, they're going to start worrying. There's both experienced teams, but you got to think, if you feel that maybe we should go on for a win on that map, maybe we should have been a little bit better, maybe, you know, all those options start coming to your mind, and the confidence being sky high originally for TCM, that's going to start falling away. And is this where maybe School Bus could build that momentum back?
I think School Bus is a better team on Mines for sure. They can kind of react better into the situations. They don't make ridiculous plays like TCM does, which gives them a big advantage on Mines, where it's not about making the ridiculous play, it's about making the one good play that pushes you forwards. We've also seen some interesting lineups, for instance, from TCM that have kind of been questionable in a few ways. But again, you know, these two teams are not very good on mines, I have to say. Yeah, okay, it might have been School Bus's choice, but it's only a 50% win ratio throughout the whole season, the online phase, which is not our whole deal when you consider TCM's is 40%. It's 10% difference, so it could go both ways. We've seen some fantastic tactics from both these two teams on this map, so I think it's going to be about execution. You know, which team's north, which team's south, how is it all going to be played through? Because, you know, from the north, you've got the advantage of the hill. From the south, you've got a little bit more kind of defensive tactics. You know, do you want to camp to bring it 3-3? That means we move on to the tiebreaker, which is Sand River. Which team has the better tactic on the tiebreaker map? It's all these kind of factors coming in. But to be honest, I don't think it's going to move on to that. I think one of these two is going to take it on this one.
I was about to say, the danger of Sand River, I think we all know that now after looking at the grand finals, how Virtus Pro had to kind of bow out in the end. Something that I think a lot of us questioned their choice of that map and the sides they went for. And it's not something you necessarily really want to depend on, Sand River. It's kind of your last chance saloon. It's kind of the last ditch effort, if anything. And I don't think these two will win that map. I'm hoping they wouldn't, because even with practice on this, it can't be defined in just practice alone. It's so much on the line here. So I think we're going to have to see these two really going for the victory on this one, because other than that, it'll be going to Prokhorovka, which I wouldn't want to face School Bus on, to be completely honest with you. They're still very strong on that map, in my opinion. But still, Mines, TCM, I'm trying to think back to their play style. Did they ever go for that defensive play in the south? Was that one of the tactics they'd depend on?
They've used the double T-32 from the south for sure. They've never really been that defensive.
They put Still Mojo a little bit further forward, don't they?
Yeah, they like to play with him a lot. From the north, you also have Still Mojo in that T-32 often going hull down. He's such a good player in this map. I mean, a lot of people say to me, okay, Still Mojo, a little bit old, a little bit slow. Sorry, Still Mojo. But he's not. He's fantastic. He's great in the T-32. He's really adaptive. He knows when to push.
He's like a fine wine. He gets better with age.
Exactly. He's amazing in that T-32 especially. So he can push forwards. He knows when to take the shot. He knows when to reverse, despite the fact that maybe he has a little bit of an advantage with the hull down tank. So, you know, I think it's going to be pivotal around him. What is Magus going to do in the Tier 1s? I think, you know, we haven't seen much of the Tier 1s for this whole matchup. So it's going to be interesting how that one plays, of course. You know, this could be the final match.
Certainly could be. Whoever wins, if I'm not mistaken, will actually walk away with the victory all in all. And an interesting parking spot there from Marmalee. Just put himself in the sign. But yes, as we said, in the south in red, it will be School Bus. In the north in blue, it's TCM. And now we can discuss the sides here, because this changes a lot of what we can kind of theorize towards the outcome. Now, I've seen School Bus breaking that southern defense on the red side that we've seen occasionally. It looks like they're embracing it to an extent. And what tanks are they going for? And what can TCM do about it?
They've gone with the T-32, IS-3, MX-1500, double AMX-1390, of course those two tier ones there as well. So a little bit of everything near you with a fantastic AMX-5100 providing good firepower, arc lit, hull down. And of course, Amelie and the IS-3 also can go hull down, but just a little bit more firepower. Some damage heading towards School Bus immediately. Arc lit taking one there in the phase, 268 damage. So initial aggression from TCM. They've got a very heavy lineup, you know, AMX-5100, IS-3, T-32, double AMX-1390 is actually mirrored. But from the north, you usually pick a lighter lineup because you can get the hill, which neither of these two teams have done.
Interesting choices. So Dark God Zim has gone down very early on. He was the tier one who's tucked in towards that northeast village, more to the east, actually, tell a lie. It's not towards the north, it's where TCM are. But still, that does lose some of the vision, actually, of where TCM are going to be heading towards. Army and Arclit can guess away, get that pre-fire going, but there's always that little danger. And it looks like Eurofish and Still Mojo, they're moving forward. They're going to be committing to this.
Yeah, TCM are committing 100%. Arclit missing that shell, actually hitting the wall in front of him. So Armini's going to have to try and extend it through. But they've got there in a good position immediately.
And Apoel and Shanish are going on the rotate around the hill. And Shanish gets caught on the push. Dead Hunter's up there as well. They could actually pincer in TCM here. Arklet, Armley, and Niyu need to stay alive well enough to get these 1390s into position to get that fire going. And here we go. TCM are going to make a little bit of a Hail Mary here. They are going all out for this. And here comes the fire. Apwell finally gets up there. Arklet lets off the shells fly, and Thoris is down to nothing. 16 HP left. Arklet is low. They're backing off the hill. Shanish takes down Thoris, but not without a little bit more damage received, as Yizni did find one back. And my God, TCM have turned it around. Can you believe it? Shanish, Apwell, near you stand in the matter, but you've got to worry. They're in a bad spot here.
Nice little shot there for near you, but yeah, TCM can actually go for the cap. Plenty of time to do it as well. 2-for-1 exchange there. Still, Mojo got to be careful. Yes, he's playing the T32, but he can't go hull down. TCM, if they hang on, if they keep themselves in this game, they can certainly win it. Shanish can't extend on the hill. And that's the great thing. If you have that southern place where TCM is, you can actually stop the other team from pushing on the hill because they get spotted immediately. Everyone knows that. If you're on the hill and you're from the other team as a south, you're going to get spotted. You're going to get taken down real quick, especially when you consider near you is the only one who can really do that. And he's playing the AMX 5100. He's kind of on his own. And look at that. Eurofish, the playmaker, the MVP, heading around, going to be trying something new. And the tier ones for TCM playing it well as well. One goes on the island to try and, you know, make sure he doesn't get killed so he can stop the cap. One heading up north, right around the corner, A1, around that rock area, to also stop the cap if that comes down to it. But TCM still got to play careful, but are going to start it.
So Shanish and Apwell going for the cap, moving in with Dead Hunter. Is Niyu just waiting there to try and reset?
Yeah,
is that his one job?
He's pretty much just to go in there to reset. He's still got maybe enough HP to deal with one tank and make one shot.
That's it. 27 seconds on the board for School Bus. There is time to play with. Let's make sure we stick with near you so we can actually watch, see when he goes for that reset. Spectator, make sure you get over there. Please go on near you. Please, please stop watching Shanish right now. There we go, because here we are. There comes the shot out. And 8 seconds left, 7 seconds. He's got the shot off, but was it enough to reset that?
Well, the reset has got to come in from TCM Gaming.
I think they've got it. School Bus, how the hell did they just capture that? How did TCM just allow them to do that? School Bus just win it.
Yeah, School Bus.
TCM went, John, we did really well today. Let's give it over to School Bus.
Yeah, that was cataclysmic from them. They kind of relied a little bit too much on those tier ones, the tier one to stop the cap.
Oh,
and the tier one on the Lighthouse Island could have also stopped the cap. And Eurofish being on his own wasn't good enough to push forwards. Maybe expected that School Bus would actually try and go up. So that was just all round interesting play from TCM Gaming, but lacked that little bit of execution.
It was perfect to that point.
Yeah.
They'd broken the south camp. They broke that. That was one of the big issues on this map sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
We saw so many teams struggling with it at the start. That southern lockdown, we saw those heavy tanks in play. TCM rolled straight through. They took them down. They took control. And that was it. And then we had what? Apwell alive and a couple of others. Not many. Near you was the only player nearby. And somehow, TCM just couldn't manage to turn it around then. That's going to haunt them, I feel, in this tournament.
Yeah, you rely too much on one tank, the tier one in that instance, and you can often get yourself in a tricky situation. You need at least two tanks, one to make the mistake, one to make the damage, and that's what TCM failed to do that time. Yeah. I would have expected also Eurofish to try and deal with near you, or at least send two tanks.
They just seemed to try and ignore
Or just
him.
More tanks in the cap for TCM. They were sticking around the cap for too long. When they could have actually just gone for it and won the game straight away.
I genuinely feel that's going to haunt them because they do obviously have the chances through the lower side again.
Mm-hmm.
They're not just flat out. But when you make that sort of mistake, it will come back and it will just sit there in the back of your mind, are we making the right choice? Is this the correct thing to go for? Because there must have been a breakdown in communication or just that little jitter of nerves coming in towards the end where they're just like, okay, do we reset them? Do we go for the cap ourselves? Where do we pull this? Because they were playing so well to that point. They'd done perfectly. Cliff, I don't think we were too surprised at. I think we knew that School Bus can be strong. They were at the very start, as you mentioned, slowing a little down towards the end of it, but still, they have that talent there. And TCM didn't really get into that. But at the end, you've got to worry because I feel School Bus now will be getting that confidence building, whereas TCM, who I thought were the better team throughout,
mm-hmm.
will now be on that slight little kind of slope down.
Classic TCM, the better team in a lot of matchups,
yeah.
but also the team that either doesn't win or just draws it straight out. So, you know, classic TCM for doing that. So they got to go back to the drawing board for sure, but it was the jitters that did it for them.
I completely agree. And actually, let's find out on stage how School Bus are feeling with that one. Let's go over to the interview.
Absolutely. What an interesting series. And School Bus actually coming out on top of that one. Arklid, you've got to be feeling a little bit relieved right now. A little bit of a slow start for you guys. Ruinberg, didn't really work out for you. Can you just break it down for me a little bit? Did you expect what TCM did to you guys on Ruinberg, or were you kind of caught off guard?
Well, actually, we expected TCM to be on the top line where we found their 1390, but our new players didn't communicate with us as much as they should, because they were really nervous and they didn't give an info that way they were going there. So Apple didn't get enough cover and we were caught off guard there.
Absolutely. So those nerves definitely are coming into effect. You guys look like you shook them off. Himmelsdorf sort of went down to a draw. They sat back a fair bit on that one. Not much you could do there. Mines, I mean, they pushed you guys so hard. You went for a pincer. You pushed some tanks up onto the hill as well. What was going through your minds when they pushed into your base as a response? Were you expecting that? Was your cap sort of a last-ditch effort, or was it all planned?
Well, we did what we do best. We reacted to the situation. We counted how much time they needed to take the base, what tanks we had there to counter the cap, and what tanks they could send to counter their cap. So we played it out with some bit of luck, actually. But I must say that we were shooting really bad there, because we were nervous and the hands a bit shaky. So it could have gone down a different way if we were shooting better. But it was as you saw. So maybe luck helped us. So.
Well, there's plenty of time to get the shooting right later on. You guys obviously moving through to the next round. Thank you very much, Arklid from School Bus, for joining us. Now, analysts, there's plenty to break down over here. So I'll let Dorjan start us off.
I'm speechless, absolutely speechless. We made our predictions before, and I'll reveal those in a second, but that last game, TCM did an amazing job, absolutely amazing job. And then what happened? What happened?
Like I said, when they killed their school bus tanks in their base, that they should start the cap immediately. I don't know what they were doing. They were reloading their guns, but they didn't start the cap. So that gave the school bus the time to move from the middle to TCM cap area and start to cap with three tanks. And they were ready for Devil to come from the water to reset. And all the stakes were on Devil to reset the cap, but he couldn't do it.
Yeah, it was too much for Devil. They knew that he was coming from that direction. They waited, they got him. The reset didn't happen. But then the reset for TCM wouldn't have been enough anyway. He would have had to hit at least two tanks, because they were down to two cappers, TCM were, and they had 11%. It was almost no cap points remaining.
Yeah, and Ural Fist was a bit idle in that match. He was in the K7 location. He should have gone to the island closer to their own cap, so he would have had the chance to reset, but now he was like doing nothing.
Yeah.
So
now let's have a look at the moments in that match. It's Carmen, you have an opinion here. As the battle unfolded, TCM pushed up. You couldn't believe the positioning of School Bus, could you?
I couldn't believe that they are missing shells. If they miss like three or four shells for these tanks, they was dead without any damage. 3.32 also without any damage, almost any damage. And they also got the damage on the 1390s.
Yeah.
The only chance was to start cap. And Uralfish can do two things. Try to decap, or before, just kill the 5100. And if you kill 5100, nothing to decap on the cap of School Bus, because all the tanks were there. Mistake, but also I think the biggest mistake was map earlier. Not good shooting, okay. This map maybe was not that big.
Which
map? Cliffs. But Himmelsdorf, in my opinion, it was poor win for TCM. With these tanks, they should just go to the cap after Uralfish, will clip out the six shells, go to cap with T1, they are capped because they have three ES3s and two 5100s only. And they have four 5100s. So they can't block the Mordor line and it's gone. It's win.
Okay, but Wilkie, you have a different opinion?
Actually, it's just overall opinion that the analytics was right after all. TCM was.
Okay, yeah. we'll get to that. Okay, he wants to bring this up. Okay, Wilkie, okay, we'll get there. I want to come to Shanissa because you were a firm supporter that TCM had this, and especially after the charge up the hill, you were like, I got it. I know this.
I was so happy TCM was leading. Like, the first match on Ruinberg, they out-rotated School Bus pretty hard. They like showed them their limits. They didn't even lose a tank, so that was demonstrating their powers. On Himmelsdorf, they were just defending. They didn't need to do anything else, but they could have actually won the map and securing like the victory on the other map.
Right, so we'll have a look at the predictions from the experts here. So as we can see, Schnitzel 3-1 to TCM. Now, with the games as they were going, could have definitely won, but wasn't in the end. But I must say, myself, Carmen, and Wilkie all said 3-2. We said that it was going to be School Bus. It was going to be School Bus, and it was purely from the experience. And I think at the end, I was on Twitter screaming, oh my God, TCM, they said they were going to bring something special today, and they really did. But the experience and the calm collection of School Bus meant they were able to do that thing at the end, where they went to cap at the
end. And for me, that's the reason why they don't have a Stalker in the team. If there will be a Stalker, it will be a Rage. And they will not, you know, they will not even try to win Himmelsdorf. It was all about the angriness in the team, trying to, you did it wrong, you are, you know, noob. And they, you know, they were calm. Alki just probably say a few words, guys, we have it. We are, you know, experienced, new guys. Remember to talk to us. We can take Himmelsdorf. Himmelsdorf was played also really slow. So they have a time to talk about it.
Yeah, well, we are going to talk about that point. We said before the match started that this is their weakness, that they are individuals. They don't have a team cohesion yet. They are still individuals, and that bit them early on. Yeah. They dropped the first, was it the first or second map? Sorry, they dropped.
They dropped
Ruinberg. Yeah, they dropped for Ruinberg because of this. Miscommunication. It was Applewow who got caught out right at the start. He played a little bit too aggressive, and that just unraveled. And then they lost the map. They dropped the first map, which was a big disaster. We were shocked. We were like, oh, okay, we might be wrong here. He was dancing. But what happened there? The individuality succeeded in the end, but was a weakness to begin with. Will this plague them for the rest of the tournament?
It's all about building the momentum. So this is a good start for School Bus because now they have the victory under the belt. They are starting to build the momentum and start to work as a team. Because after all, this is a team game. If you have the best individuals, you will still lose to the best team. You have to be the best team to win the prize.
Yeah, and that is the big issue here. TCM worked really well, but they made a bad decision at the end. Their decision-making at the end, they're deciding not to cap, reload, and re-attack. School Bus like, we've got limited time here. We need to go cap. And they just abandoned ship. They just left the fight, left one tank behind to reset, who did a beautiful job, reset it, but it was too late for TCM. They didn't foresee the School Bus would quickly react, adjust to their tactic. Now, we want to bring this up, that Ollie pointed out during the game that he disagreed that TCM is a reactive team. He said that he disagreed completely with you guys that TCM would react well. And looking at the final map, I have to side with Ollie at this point.
To be me, it was not the worst reaction ever. They could start the capping, but they, you know, they didn't have much information, and at the moment, they were afraid that it worked really well. If they would have this ES3 closer and it will not go down, and this T32, they would probably start capping because we were afraid that, you know, we have to cap. And then, you know, why it's so easily? What we should do? Okay, we can, you know, cap is safe because there is Devil, Worldfish going back, guys, reload to be sure that you kill this 5100 and you have the game, yeah. The most important thing was that they, you know, they wasn't sure about this. It went too smooth for them, in my opinion. But also, what is very important to them, that they are now in the loser bracket, they cannot lose any game. And this is why I'm really happy to guys that they have four substitute players. Because, you know, they can talk to each other. Some of the guys, you know, if they are not feeling well, they can be substituted. And they really have, you know, they also can build a momentum because they are waiting for the game.
Okay, Wilkie?
Yeah, for the TCM being a more passive team, reacting for the School Bus, they did play the reactive game on the first four maps, but on the mines, for three maps. But on the mines, we said that they don't want to go to Sand River because we have trained with the TCM quite a lot, And to be honest, they don't play that well in the Sand River. So we knew they are going to try to win the mines. And that's what happened. And that's why they made the first move on the mines.
To me, to my amateur mind, I saw them moving up into the cap circle, busting through with a very sure plan. But I think they didn't know the next step. I don't think they actually thought it was going to work. So they got into that situation and they expected to either have had more kills or be dead. But they had neither. They had got a few kills, a lot of damage dealt, and they were still alive. And they didn't know what to do with the next step. Is that a fair assumption to make of what you think happened in the final map?
I think yes. They were like on a bad position. They didn't have eyes on the hill. The school bus had a pretty good position on that, and school bus was leading the charge after that. They were deciding because, yeah, they were just hesitating too much at that
okay.
point.
Okay, so they now we're going to talk something. About the Razer power player. So who was it for you guys out of the two choices you have? You have Eurofish as one of the players, and we have Apple WoW for the other player. So who is yours of these two matches or these matches?
At this moment, for me, Apple WoW because he won. But also one of the one of the things, Wilkie, you made it on the Ruinberg that we see that Uralfish got two or three shells yeah. at the beginning. It was Wilkie was saying, ah, classic Uralfish, too aggressive, yeah? But it really worked for
yeah,
them.
After.
And Applebaum also made this mistake.
Yes.
Because of the bad timing. But after this game, he really played well and really connected all the shells. I think, but on for my eyes, it was not only these two guys. It was also T1 from Magus on the cliffs, really good, but not lost, but... In my opinion, now I vote for Applebaum.
Okay.
Yeah. School bus one, I have to go with Applebaum.
Same here.
Applewell all the way. So Applewell seems to be the collective decision team. Well, they did win, so I guess it is the better way to put it. If they won, that is the guy who won the match. But I did like Eurofish's play on Himmelsdorf. He should have been dead. 20 seconds earlier, 30 seconds earlier. I mean, I know it was a draw. They didn't exactly win it, but... You have an opinion?
I have, yeah. My opinion is that Applebaum will kill Uralfish if not this first shell. First shell went to the tracks without any damage. If it will be good with damage, Applebaum will win and be only one shell left to kill him. But unluck of the game or, you know, poor shoot, we don't know. I don't see, you know, from the spectator that good. But really, for me, it was, you know, the fight between the two stars and Applebaum should win it.
But what happened was not only Apple was damaged, but one more school bus was taken
yeah,
down.
And
this
was a mistake.
All from that one guy. And this is why I said, like, I saw Eurofish doing some really nice stuff. So I still like him. Although they lost, I still think he played and really kept TCM in it throughout the first few maps. But it was just mines. I can't get over how that went south so quickly. I didn't even see school bus reacting as quick as they did. The decision making in their team was super fast. I don't know if it was Arklet who made that call or someone else, but whoever it was, they did the only thing they could have possibly done. At that point,
this decision was so easy because it is only decision that you play. You can ask every guy who's playing World of Tanks. If you are losing, your only chance, almost in this map, is to start to cap, and it's, you know, just from the training, you know that you have to start the cap.
The preparation they had, though, to know exactly where Devil's going to come from, and the sloppy play from Eurofish from not getting back sooner and not going out wider, as you pointed out, Wilkie, kind of cost them the match. But that is those two teams. They didn't do it. Make sure you go and vote. And I think Melee wants to talk about these sort of social media aspects of things. So, Melee, you got something to say?